Bob made this agenda with the intention of it being, what, an hour and 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Perfect.
That's the time stamp that we're
in. I'm in awe. Right. I'm gonna
All right, call the meeting to order.
Yeah.
Call the roll. Spencer Brandt?
Aye.
George Thurlow?
Here.
Robert Geis? Here. Who's taking minutes? Anybody?
If you want me to, I will.
Okay.
That'd be good.
I need to borrow some paper from you.
Did we put out minutes for the last meeting?
Yes, we did. I sent them to...
Yeah, I think they were distributed with the agenda.
The only thing I got with the agenda was two items, but maybe I didn't look at the right one. I got attachment A and...
What was it? An attachment A was the attachment that you included.
From George.
Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry. Maybe I didn't send them out.
All right, send them out for the next time. We'll approve them at the next meeting.
Okay. Sounds good. Sorry about that.
And then I'll probably need...
Public comment?
4 pages.
No public comment?
Oh, okay.
I guess just my only comment during the public comment period.
2 pages.
Something not on the agenda. I think we should just keep this notion of, if the public is not going to be really interested in this meeting, everything we forward out of our meeting eventually gets to the open agenda on the full board of directors. So I think we comply with the Brown Act, and it would be a lot nicer if this was an advisory committee that we could work during, between meetings, because you're busy, I'm busy, you're busy, and boy, you just don't get any... You know, like, I didn't do anything since I did out the agenda because I just didn't have time to work on it. Yeah. So,
yeah.
Anyways.
No, I echo those 100%. And I think like, the nature of what we're doing, too. I mean, because we're telling you, hey, make a call to Mona, see if you can do this, this, and this. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure it'd be a lot more helpful if, like, when we delegate tasks like that, we would be able to communicate with one another outside of the meetings.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in the future, like, if we want to put an item on the agenda, and, I mean, there will come a time for agenda items later in the meeting, but,
let's just let it go another meeting, but I think we should just kind of measure that.
Yeah, because the other thing that I've noticed is that originally when it was brought up just at the first meeting, when we were just kind of testing the waters and seeing what people thought, a lot of the people who had really expressed interest in, like, being on the committee, I haven't seen at the meeting since then, so.
So this would be an ad hoc, officially an ad hoc
I think
committee.
I think it would be better for the organization if the finance committee, if this committee was an ad hoc committee. I just think it would work better. It seems like the policy committee is the same way, you know, we're working on.
Yeah.
Especially since the board of directors is doing the work, it just seems like that. Anyways, that's just public comment.
You don't want to for that as a recommendation now?
Why? We can't. It's not agendized.
Oh, we can put it on the next. I'll put it on the next meeting as an agenda item.
Okay.
Just in case we want to do it.
Okay.
Okay.
And George, you had the time for a call to order. I think it was just 3 o'clock, clock on the dot.
Yeah. Okay. Item number 2. I just want to briefly discuss the referral by the district board, the issue of using the county's accounting system by requesting a special district operating fund in the county's financial system. Maybe provide some input and direction on alternatives and assign to Director Geis to provide a written report of alternatives at the next formation committee meeting. Direction could include pursuing no cost of services at the county during startup, using software for accounting such as QuickBooks, Excel accounting, etc. And so, you know, just preliminarily, I looked at QuickBooks. I had an ad come over. It's $21 a month or $500 a year for the version we'd want to use. You know, Excel has probably on somebody's computer, you could do it, but, you know, it has all its own internal control weaknesses that it's not very regimented software. In both of those issues, somebody's going to have to drive those systems. And so,
yeah.
I really would like to somehow get back and somehow get the county to waive the service costs for a couple of years, even if we just go for that. So that's probably what my report's going to say. And since we don't have any money yet, it's not imperative. I did send the letter to the county about setting up the fund to the treasurer and the auditor. I haven't heard from them, but I think they're waiting for, I didn't send them the minutes of the regular meeting approving that, so I'll send them the minutes.
Yeah, that's right, and those will go out with the agenda for
agenda.
The regular meeting.
And so we don't have a fund yet, but it won't be hard to get there.
Okay.
And that, when I set up the fund, I could probably open the discussion with them again about how to accomplish these, you know, waiver of costs for the first years or until we get money.
Mm-hmm. Have there, in your history, have you ever seen a similar situation where a district had waived costs or anything like
they
that?
They were all free until...
That's right. That's right. I forgot.
Until 5 years ago. Ivy Rec and Park has always paid because the ones that were grandfathered in were the districts that we were providing accounting services to pre-1978-79. Okay. So there was a theory that when Prop 13 came in, they were already getting those services and the county got property tax to afford to serve those. But eventually the codes changed and we broke that barrier and said, look, it's costing the county $100,000 to provide these accounting services. We're going to have to have people pay. So,
yeah.
But there hasn't been a startup district in the meantime that doesn't have any money.
Yeah. If we waived costs, this is just a technical question, but if there was an agreement to essentially waive the costs, would it just be a cost waiver on the county's part or would they be donating to us in-kind services?
They would probably, that's a good question, you know. I don't know because we haven't done it.
Yeah, okay.
We did have a fair period of time when we enacted the original fee schedule for the districts who weren't paying. We set a very low fee schedule on a fixed fee and let them pay a fixed fee until we built what their regular costs were. And then they began building the regular cost. So maybe we can enter into some fixed fee agreement, but you know, you're exactly right. We don't have any money to pay. So we have to find some money to pay or, you know, figure out how they could give us in-kind services or a contribution from other governments. So.
Yeah, because one of the things to keep in mind is that as things continue to come back to the board specifically, I'm just thinking about the policy committee who had on their agenda to make policies regarding donations.
Yeah.
That's something that if the board were to approve it, then there'd be an infrastructure for that, for the donation of in-kind services. But I'm sure other agreements could also be struck too that just waive the costs altogether or had some sort of deferred cost package.
Yeah, or you can do them as cost sharing somehow. And, when I visited the county on these services with the board, I did not get I didn't have the votes to take something forward. So the board is coming from a point of view of two members are on LAFCO. In the LAFCO process, it got to be a big deal about approving this as a district. And it got to be a big deal about what's going to happen if they don't get any money. And, you know, the positions of those board members on LAFCO are, well, they sure better not come back and ask the general fund.
Yeah.
If this is the way we're going to process this, and you're going to form a district with potentially no money, don't come to the general fund. Lavanino sent me that message on my appointment in no uncertain terms.
Yeah.
And another visit with the board, I got the answer of, if it's about the Ivy Rec and Park District, the answer is no. Now, what do you have to say? And so getting that support on the board, we're going to have to be very compelling about how we do it. So anyways, I don't want to give up on this because I think it's best for the district to have a good accounting system with strong internal controls, and we don't want to invent that. It would be much more costly. So anyways, if you guys just make a motion to refer it back to me.
So move.
And we're referring this
item for me to do a written report.
For you to do a written report.
Back to the formation committee.
Yeah, okay, second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, number two, Discuss referral by district board the issue of a strategic plan to solicit donations, assign tasks to a formation committee member to invite IBCDC board members or staff to the next formation committee on, this is April 21st, to discuss their vision of fundraising for IBCSD and how it would fit into a strategic plan for IBCSD.
So there's, it feels to me like there's two parts to that. Tell me if I'm wrong there. One is the strategic plan, which is over here, and the other is IVCDC, which is over here.
Right. And so I guess the reason I put it like that is because I don't understand the relationship with IVCDC. I haven't looked at this plan for service. I don't know what their role was in the district formation process. I didn't come to all those meetings. You know, I know that they're a nonprofit that weren't in existence for a while and they came back into existence. Well, they were always in existence, but they probably didn't file tax returns. They didn't do any fundraising. They didn't do anything up until formation. And, you know, my gut reaction is they think that they got involved in the transfer of these buildings for the state. And I know that they sent letters to the state, but I guarantee you, if that organization thinks that's why they were successful in getting these buildings for the community, they're just flat out wrong. These buildings got granted to the county because that's how the redevelopment agency law was structured. And the county council, and the team that was the redevelopment agency dissolution team, they were the ones that successfully and legally got these assets transferred to the community. It was a great idea, and it required a lot of work, and it did get community support, but you know, legally, these are assets of the county. So I just don't get, I think somebody's got to get me up to speed on the relationship with IBCDC.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I'll stop you right there in and of the fact that I don't think that this has a whole lot to do with the acquisition of these buildings. I know that IBCDC has been pretty involved, and I'll do full disclosure, I sit on the board of the IBCDC, not representing them, obviously, but because I recently got on the board, like, a couple months ago, like, I think 3 months ago now. I can tell you, though, that the organization has, in the past, been really involved in promoting self-governance in Isla Vista, and they... right now, you know, as per what Jonathan has said, are doing some sort of small fundraising on behalf of the district. I think that what we really need to do is get a representative from the organization there that can speak on behalf of the organization.
I think so. Yeah.
Probably to one of these meetings.
Right. And that's my suggestion.
So is it to appear here for this committee or to appear for the full board?
I mean, I think it would definitely be better in this committee. I think we can have a more in-depth discussion in this committee than we would at the full board. That's my gut reaction. What do you think?
I think we should start here because I'd really like to get... I don't want to shut off the ability for them to do fundraising for us. I'd sure like to understand their mission better and why they're a good partner for us to do fundraisings. And I want to make sure that's why I brought that donation policy forward.
Yeah.
I experienced conflict of interest between nonprofit organizations and the county during my career about who's fundraising for whom, and you can get into some difficulties there. I was a little bit shocked at the board meeting to see that they were already the registered fundraising site on our website, and I go, I thought we said, hey, these five things are approved by the board to go on there, and all of a sudden they're the fundraising website.
So I'm a director on that board of directors as well.
Uh-huh.
And as for speaking for them, I don't think there's anything in our bylaws that prevents me to. So I can just join the conversation if you'd like, or you can ask Cameron.
Yeah, we'll ask for comments from the public. We should have did that on one too, because I forgot. So anyways, we'll continue the discussion, then we can take your comment.
Sure, it's not so much a comment, but you were describing that you would like to have someone representative of that organization here to speak to you on behalf of them. I could possibly do that.
Well, I think the board should probably take action to designate some sort of a liaison, like to this organization, so we don't end up making sure that everyone's on the same page.
So I would make the motion that Spencer, you be the liaison and invite who you think appropriate to the next meeting, mm-hmm. and just come and speak, talk to the organization, and explain the vision of the relationship between IVCDC and IVCSD. Somebody has that vision, or it's been, everybody seems to know it on the board, but I don't really understand it.
I don't understand it either. Mm-hmm. So I'm not suspicious of it, I just don't understand
it. You don't understand it, yeah. I think that there is some clarification.
Since there's a lot of concern and issues about agreements, mm-hmm. there should be some agreement here, even if it's mm-hmm. only one paragraph, that they're going to... Yeah. Because here's the thing, is you guys could all be gone 3 years from now, and we're working without any kind of agreement.
Yeah, no,
and
I
now
agree.
There's a whole new group of people mm-hmm. who... so it seems like we should also... Yeah. begin a discussion about some kind of informal agreement.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would hope that out of the conversation that we have where we start clarifying what their relationship is with the IVCSD would be some sort of an agreement, some sort of an MOU or whatever it may be, just regarding whatever it is that we come to.
Yeah. So I have a motion in it. Did somebody second my motion?
Yes. Motion is that Spencer be the liaison to IVCDC and invite a speaker to the next formation committee meeting. And good. I'll second that.
You second? All in favor?
Aye.
And then the second part of this, we broke it into two pieces, was, you know, the issue of a strategic plan to solicit donations. Do we want to hold off on that until we talk about the broader issue on agenda item 7?
Yeah.
Okay. I make a motion we just talk about the strategic plan as part of item number 7.
I don't think you need a motion for that. Cool. It's already in the plan.
So number 3. Any public comment on number 2 or number 1?
Number 1. Sure. So my question would be, and this kind of was covered in the discussion about IVCDC, is if you end up using the fund or having the fund, so my first question is, can you just funnel money in at any time? Because it seems like that's not how it would work. And if you can't do that, does that mean that the CSD is going to need like a temporary bank account for like incoming funds until it can close enough account at the county level?
No, the count at the county level, we just have to wait for the minute order, and we'll be able to set up that account.
But it's like your question is, how does that work? And it's true. Yeah.
The county,
that's something we need clarification on.
The county treasury is just like a bank. You just take their money in there, and you deposit it just like a bank.
So you can deposit, my question is though, you can deposit money at any time, regardless of what's currently in the fund?
It sounds like
you can deposit money anytime once the fund's set up.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And the fund's going to be set up. It would be illegal at this point in time, until the board would set it up, to put the money outside the county treasury, because the law says any district money that is received has to go in the county treasury.
Okay, so there would have to be. Okay.
And then we might. You know, just to carry this discussion a little further between the public, you might be able to sell up a local bank account that's tied to the treasury that makes it easier to funnel money from next door at Bank of America to the treasury. So some people have little depository sub accounts.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, but the treasurer would be the signatory on those accounts, not someone from the district. So. Okay, number 3. Assign a formation committee staff member to compile a proposed amendment to the current district conflict of interest policy to include adoption of a conflict of interest code, include an appendix for disclosure categories, review local agency biannual noticing requirements of the County of Santa Barbara Clerk Recorder, use Goleta Water District and Goleta Sanitary District documents as guideposts to compile an IBC CSD policy revision and enhancements to comply with legal code sections.
Yeah, so I'll kind of start on just because I don't think this is something that our committee has any jurisdiction over, given that it is a policy amendment.
Right.
I think that, so we, I don't think we can speak very much about the substance of a policy regarding a conflict of interest, an amendment to a conflict of interest code. It's something that, just as we did on the last issue when you brought us the fundraising document and the policy that the county had, we can forward it to the full board as a recommendation that the policy committee handles it, but I don't think we can have any discussion regarding the substance of a policy.
So I would just disagree for this reason. Number one, Sheila has from the elections office called me personally, not because of who I was or not because she knew me, but because I had filed my statement with them and she didn't have anything to match it against. Mm-hmm. Jay, at the regular board meeting, did something right on the policy. They established the policy by reference. Goleta West does the same thing.
Yeah.
But they didn't take the next step to develop the disclosure categories. So they usually, if you do it by reference, then behind it you have the what they refer to as an Appendix A for disclosure categories. So that Appendix A for disclosure categories is in a certain form of what your disclosure categories are, and then who the officials are that are subject to that conflict of interest code. So far, we only have directors, so only directors. And the reason then you take that conflict of interest code, you send it over to the county clerk recorder or elections, they then have a document that when we send in these forms, they know what they're matching against. They put it in the file with our required disclosures. And then biannually, the county by law, some other code section, sends out to each filing officer or district, it says you need to update your conflict of interest code. So that update happens biannually. I just so happen to have a copy of Goleta West by reference, and I have Goleta West's update and their conflict of interest code, and then I have Goleta Water, who actually didn't do it by reference, but has a much clearer explanation of the code as part of their policy, which is, I think, is superior to this vague reference that we have that requires us to go look up these. What is a conflict with these references to these complex codes? And so I think Goleta Water has done a really nice job, because they have a lawyer who's rewriting their policies, of saying, well, what is a real conflict of interest code? If you go read it, you know what it means. And then second to that, they have an Appendix A for their disclosure. So my goal of this is, if you refer this back to me, I'll put together a draft to just forward to the policy committee. Otherwise, I can just send them a bunch of piece of paper.
I just don't think it's something that we can direct you to do, because it is.
All we're doing is do whatever we want.
Well, it's broken. That policy is broken. The policy is not good.
That's fine. We can recommend that the board forward an extensive conflict of interest policy to the policy committee. I just want, you know,
we're just trying to save them time. Otherwise, they're going to sit around. That none of them have any background in local government or conflicts of interest policies or any of that. So they'll spend hours and hours and hours and hours and hours debating it, when we can take what another agency's done and paid a really high-priced attorney to write.
Well, listen, that is what the policy committee essentially does.
All we're doing is trying to help them.
But if the policy committee did not do enough research to complete the task, How do we get, how do we, and the public contacts us, another office?
See, again, and here's the thing, because I can give you more background on the institution of that policy, what its intention was, and I can tell you that it was meant to be a stopgap policy. It wasn't meant to be the end-all be-all of the conflict of interest policy. I really don't think that we can have this discussion, though, because it is not something that is within our jurisdiction as a committee.
Sure it is. All it is a formation activity that the original policy is not sufficient to carry out.
The extent to which we can have the conversation is that what you were speaking about, how we don't have, say, a filing officer, the county elections, they don't have anything to file it against. So that's as much as it can be a item that is a formation item. We really got to be careful with what
we don't. I differ with you. Yeah. Come on. We're getting hung up on process.
All right.
It's just like
we
had
get
this
hung up on
I'll
process
just
hung, because
I'll
the
just
board
forward,
gets hung up
I'll
on
just
process.
Forward
and that's a problem with our board.
I agree.
I'll just forward to the policy committee the information that I have as a request by Sheila Hess to fix it.
I think that would be great.
Okay. That's
okay.
Good.
I will refer my information to the policy committee.
Okay. And you withdraw that motion?
Yes.
I'm not trying to be argumentative.
No.
Me either.
I just want to get shut down.
Yeah.
I
so number four.
I agree.
Number four.
Yeah.
Come on, we're on our thing. Discuss a plan to guide the work of the formation committee. Consider formatting a document to strategically consider each section of the CSD law. Discuss, take, and record actions and record accomplishments that comply with the law and further the operations of the district and its formation.
Mm-hmm.
So all I'm looking for with this part, do we have any comments on three?
No, I just think it's a good thing that it's being discussed.
Policy, okay. So I'm trying to, you know, I realize my first attempt at a work thing was from an accounting perspective, and all the work we're kind of doing is now coming from the legal perspective. It's really coming from the law that's driving it. And if you look through the law, eventually we get to the financial component of that, like George has back here. You know, what are your revenues and what are the services that the CSD law lets you provide? So I think we should think about some kind of document that, you know, I've suggested to Jay at the policy committee, well, you guys ought to come up with a, you know, an inventory of what policies we're going to work on.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think the same thing. We should come up with an inventory of what policies,
mm-hmm.
what issues the formation mm-hmm. committee is going to work on.
That's a great idea.
And
I totally agree with your idea that that's a great idea for one of our interns.
Mm-hmm.
And can we just have you guide, essentially what my vision is of what you're putting together is a grid that essentially has tasks
mm-hmm.
laid out.
Yeah, I was thinking
and
the
those
law,
tags have the code references.
Here's the law, mm-hmm. here's an action plan, here's what we accomplished.
Got it.
And it wouldn't necessarily just be what we accomplished. Let's say we are in the appointment of directors, we're in that
mm-hmm.
section. At this meeting, we took action to appoint a director, boom, that's it.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and we just go through there. So then we have a document. When somebody says, what are you guys doing?
Yeah.
We say, hey, here's our accomplishments.
Right.
And we're
mm-hmm.
we're following the law and getting organized. So
yeah.
Does that make sense to everybody?
Oh, 100%.
Yeah.
I think that I agree with you, George. This sounds like a great thing for us to assign to an intern, especially since this will probably be one of the intern's first projects, and it'll be a good way for them to familiarize themselves with what a special district is, all of those things.
Right.
So I think what would be really helpful would be there needs to be some sort of, I don't know if it's a template or what it is, but some sort of a way for us to, because we don't want to just hand the intern the code and say, go pick out everything we need to do and make a list.
No, I was
there
thinking,
should be some
yeah,
sort of a template.
I agree.
The first column is insert the code.
Mm-hmm.
The second column is figure out the actions we already took.
Right.
The third column is how do we make something an accomplishment? How do we show it?
So, and I may be lost here, which is not unusual, but I'm thinking we're taking your template that you already have, which is what we were going to use as our work plan.
Yeah, I think we should incorporate that work plan into that template in the finance section.
Yeah. Well, but the work plan is largely, or maybe not largely, but a lot of it is based off of things that the code requires us to do, right?
Yeah, and I would...
I think the two go hand in hand.
Yeah, and I think I would break the work plan into each of the code sections. And mm-hmm. So it doesn't get to be an overwhelming document. We break it into its chapters and then get, you know, how do we get done with that chapter?
So does it feel to you like, I mean, I've just met these three interns. They're super bright.
That's why
the cream of the crop.
They can help me set up the template. They're smarter than me.
Do we want to have you just go ahead and lead that?
I think
activity.
Spencer's going to be their boss. And so I think I should communicate to Spencer and have Spencer lead that intern.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
I think that would be great. All I would ask is for more clarification on what the template you think should look like, how you think this intern should go about breaking this up, because I don't want to overwhelm them, given that they're already going to be taking on a lot of duties in terms of figuring out what they have to do to notice meetings and write agenda items. It's going to be a lot on their plate, so anything that there could be a template that would be able to make it more digestible would be helpful.
I'll think about
that. I think that also what I was going to say is
I have somebody that's really smart that I'll consult.
By the way, are you in this meeting tomorrow? I only know about it because it's a current, because I had to get a room for it. Are you in the orientation or is it just Ethan?
I believe that's just Ethan.
Okay.
I'm going to reach out to you.
So they're being oriented tomorrow by Ethan, mm-hmm. and then I assume they're going to be...
And I could
sign out so they can start next week.
I could make a stab at how I would look at a project plan for an intern for this particular project and see if I can articulate that in a format to forward to you to.
That would be super helpful.
Yeah. Okay. Let me try. I'll commit to that.
That would be great. And the last thing that I would say is because I don't know if we want to have some sort of a timeline for when this project gets done. But the next step, it would seem to me after that, is kind of what Bob was mentioning, is like we need some sort of a benchmark to track what we've done and like what our goals were, did we accomplish them. So that I think should come in, I don't know, some sort of a presentation form that can be kind of like the capstone of all this, because I think there's definitely a real need for us as a district to remind people these are the things that we are doing right now. These are the things we set out to do. We accomplished them.
I agree.
Are we going to have an executive committee?
Are we going to?
The three officers? What did we end up doing with that, the three officers?
There was not a committee there was a committee that was created, but people were not appointed to it.
Okay.
We gave the discretion to the board president, so there will be.
So it seems to me that you and Natalie and Ethan should maybe take this up as a kind of leadership issue, which is we're not right now, but very quickly we are going to be in a time period where people are going, they haven't done anything.
Yeah, I agree
100%. And then you're going to be fighting uphill because then the narrative will have been set, we will have been branded. We're already being branded out there.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. What was the word in the headline of Independent? You know?
Yeah, I didn't read
snafu
it.
Snafu or whatever.
It was something bad. Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
So we need to be, and this is off agenda, so I won't get too far into it, but we need to start telling our own story, setting our own brand, and setting the narrative. And I think that's something where what you need to do is you need to hook it on a news item. And I don't know what that is. The interns, okay? So you hook it on, you know, I mean, I'll tell you something, Poli Sci is doing a huge press release on these three interns.
Mm-hmm.
We should do the same thing, and we set a narrative, which is, hey, see, you know, we're doing it, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So anyway, but that's off agenda, so I won't get...
I agree. But I think I have, now that just triggers my mind, I think in the auditor's office, we went through this exercise of what the auditor's statutory responsibilities are, mm-hmm. and we have a format that the statutory responsibilities of the auditor are like huge.
Oh, yeah.
And you know, you go, well, where did that come from? And it was a really interesting exercise to record that, and we have a format for it. I know it doesn't have accomplishments on it, so I'll look at that and see if I can dream up what a model would look
like. Well, I mean, what I imagine is that once this is compiled and you have, say, the thing that we're responsible for doing, the code that's linked to that, the category of what it is, and you're able to sort that into different things, then it'll be easier for this committee to prioritize what we're going to try to get done first.
It'll be,
and then we can set
we
the
should
goal.
Prioritize with it. Use once we get the inventory, then we should prioritize what chapter should we work on. Because I'm kind of in agreement with George that we need to work on a chapter that shows results. And probably gets us back to what you guys put on the very first agenda are, when are we going to go for the next tax increase? When are we going to, when is there writing on the wall that we will go back for a tax increase?
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, that's what at least one high exec in the county said to me, well, your whole focus should be on getting that tax increase, and where's your plan? And we have, and they don't see that on the agenda, and there's high-level people reading those agendas, and it's not getting there. The message isn't being sent that where our priorities are right.
Yeah.
So
no,
how do we get that
I
on? How do we get that on an agenda?
Well, listen. From my perspective, I had been putting it on the agenda, the discussion of the future funding options, and after a couple meetings, well, the first meeting we never even got to it, which I thought was really unfortunate. But then when we started going into the conversation surrounding it, it didn't really seem like we delegated some stuff, and that was basically about it. So I would be happy to continue to put that item on the full board agenda, the discussion of future funding options, because I think it should be a priority.
I think it should be, and I think that you should, that could be a committee in and of itself, and it has to be done in a legal way. So, for example, we can't use UCSB interns for anything having to do with that. That's because they're paid university employees. I gotta be careful. You're okay, I think.
Yeah.
But I think we should have a committee, and I think your point is it's right now. We gotta start. It's only November.
Right. The high priority opportunities on your list.
And if I haven't, and if I haven't been supportive enough, then I've missed the boat, because I should have been pushing that too.
Yeah.
I will. I'll certainly put it back on.
Let's put it up at the top of the agenda if you can. You put the agenda together.
I'm happy to.
That'd be great.
Okay.
So. So, I mean, we already
so I think we got a plan. We don't need to take any action. Do we need to take any action? We're just gonna refer this to.
Note that I said that I'll put the item on the agenda, the future funding item on the agenda, and in regards to the code section, note that we just. I don't think we need to take any action on it. Just note that Bob's going to forward me over some sort of a template, and I'm going to work with the intern once I'm assigned. Mm-hmm. I have another opportunity to meet them.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to it. I have some stuff ready regarding.
I think it'll be a fun project for an intern.
Oh, yeah.
It has a beginning and an end, and we don't have to set the expectation that he in 10 weeks he has to do every section of code. It's even better. He or she, yes. All right, so we have action and no motions necessary on item 4.
I don't think a motion is necessary.
Okay. And number 5, we
I think we just did that.
Just made a motion to assign Director Brandt to assist the committee in completing the plan discussed in 4 above. Do we need to so move? Assign to Director Brandt?
I don't think so.
Okay, just take action.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Number six, briefly review the code sections related to director's representation at meetings of other agencies. Take action or defer to the full board. So this 61047, if you really read those sections, they're related to board members, committee members, making representation other committee meetings and getting paid. Mm-hmm. That's why it's in there. Wow. So mm-hmm. the Goleta Water District guy shows up at this meeting mm-hmm. and he gets paid for it. But
that's right.
I think the content of those sections should be considered by the policy committee mm-hmm. for when it's appropriate and when not for a director to act as a representative at another committee meeting. And it came up at the regular meeting yesterday, at a regular meeting of somebody going, a request by someone that the Senate, we go to the Student Senate and have a representative mm-hmm. Make regular reports to that meeting. So I think we should make sure that there's some kind
there
of policy
be a formalized process
place.
For how that person gets selected,
yeah.
even where we just decided that I am going to be the liaison.
Right.
There needs to be some sort of a formal process because in one instance we had a company board and now it's coming out of committee.
Right.
So you're right. There does need to be some sort of a formal process. In looking through this code though, I saw the same thing that you did. This seems like it pertains mostly to getting compensated for representing
yeah.
the district.
I only referred to the code sections because
yeah.
there's some good language in there.
Okay.
Code language about how you could write a policy. And, you know, it brings up the different instances. There's more than one, right? There's more than one instance of where somebody goes
yeah.
and represents themselves. It's like
there's
other
a distinction between a public agency or a hearing at a meeting or a public benefit nonprofit corporation.
Right. So if you guys are representing positions on the IBCDC, or then somebody's going to go to LAFCO and represent a position, or somebody's going to go to mm-hmm. the Special Districts Association and represent a position, or the statewide committee, I think we should make that more formal. Because you don't want somebody mm-hmm. rogue
oh, yeah.
going to LAFCO and or Board of Supervisors and representing that they're speaking on behalf of the full board without maybe
yeah,
something
I
being
agree.
Heard.
Well, not to overstep, but it seems like most boards, and I don't know about public boards, the Board of Supervisors is a little more, the power is a little bit more diffuse, but it seems like the way that most handle it is the board president is the only one authorized to speak on behalf of the board.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just the policy. And no other board member is authorized to speak on behalf of the board unless they're designated by the president to speak
yeah.
on behalf of the
oh,
board.
Oh, yeah, we can do it that way.
Mm-hmm. I think that seems like a really good template. I, again, don't want to get too far into it because it will be something that's considered
yeah.
by the policy committee, but it's good that you brought this to our attention and I'm looking at it.
So I just would refer
to the code.
This issue in the code sections to the policy committee.
Okay. I move that we refer the issue of external representation as it pertains to section, what is it,
61047, yeah.
To the policy committee for formulation of policies.
I'll second.
Any comment?
Sure, actually. I don't know if you can do this legally in your codes or in Robert's Rules of Order or whatever, but I was just thinking that you guys have now had two kind of nice discussions about potential actions for policy committee, and I know you're not allowed to make those because that's policy committee, but it seems like as part of referring code and referring things to policy committee, it would be nice to have like some of your conclusions or discussions. For example, suggestion that Director Thurlow made, which is pretty good, I think. I think it was, you know, really viable option. And it seems like that should also be something the policy committee hears. And I know that Spencer's on policy committee, but you guys could actually refer it. It seems like it would help the other committee out. I don't know if that's legal.
Well, it's partly it's that's why we take really good minutes. And then the other committees should be looking at our minutes.
Yeah.
But if the guy who's taking the minutes.
I, as a member of other committees, am very appreciative of that.
And see, the code section that Spencer's looking at, that goes a little bit farther because it's authorizing people to get paid. Mm-hmm. That says the board has to take that action. So it's, you know, if you do it with just the president taking action, that policy would probably be, you know, you can only represent yourself to another agency if we've taken action and in a clear position on whatever item they're discussing.
Mm-hmm. I would just say that because of the way that the board has decided to structure these committees as Brown Act committees, there are a certain level of constraints that we operate under that, in my opinion, are becoming more and more apparent that it's not advantageous to us being able to do work. And it's something that is very much on my mind. And it sounds like we're going to have an item on the next formation committee meeting agenda. And I guess this kind of transitions nicely into next agenda items. Is that the next thing on the agenda? Or are there other
things? The next thing on the agenda is discuss and take action on possible revenue opportunities for the
district. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see that. Yeah. My computer died. But yeah, it's definitely something that I think we should discuss at a future meeting when it's agendized.
Yeah. What was it? The issue of?
The issue of the structure of the formation committee.
Oh, yeah. I got that
possibly
written down.
Asking the board to make it into an ad hoc committee.
Yeah, because I think we'll, as we go through the structure, you know, maybe in there we could, as we're reviewing the structure, the action could be refer that to the policy committee, refer that to the policy committee, rather than us agendizing something, formulating the policy on our behalf, like we think it should be structured, and giving it to them. So I think I think that can...
Yeah, because I find that, I mean, it's nice, like, from, I don't know how much I can speak on it, but it's nice from my perspective as someone who sits on both committees to have, like, at least a little bit of a jumping off structure.
Yeah.
But it is kind of an awkward workflow.
I get it. And it takes a long time.
Yeah.
To get stuff done.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the truth. But I really appreciated it.
Yeah. All right. I think we got it. We'll put that on the next committee. All right. Number seven, discuss and take action on possible revenue opportunities for the district. We're very well thought out, Mr. Thurlow.
Notice that I just died when I said you better tell a compelling story.
Yeah.
I was going to write a whole treatise on it, and then I just died and said, you better have a compelling story for all of these.
Right.
Seems to me on this one is that we've taken the most important step already, which is we got to get going on the tax. And so we get a committee formed to start working on the strategy, the plan, how that's going to work. The other piece of it that comes up is you can talk about this stuff all day long.
Right.
And unless you tell someone,
go do it.
George, you're going to go to the Santa Barbara Foundation. Bob, you're going to go to the county. Spencer, you're going to go to the Fund for Santa Barbara.
Mm-hmm.
He'll never get done.
Yeah.
So it seems to me that in the last 5 minutes that we're here today, that we figure out, so what's our what's way up here, our strategy for assigning these opportunities to people or committees or individuals? How do we want to do that?
I think a grant committee would be advantageous. I don't know if that looks like multiple ad hoc committees that are individualized to grants or just one committee that works on the grants.
I think we get too cumbersome.
With multiple ad hocs.
You know, then I'm starting to think, okay, now I'm on three committees and, you know.
Yeah.
Versus, do we want to say to the full board, we'll take this on? Do you want to take it on, Bob? Chair Geist, do you want to take this on in formation?
I think that, you know, I think for strategies for raising revenues, I don't mind me getting tasked to go meet somebody and go ask. I think that the
leadership coming out of the president is the key, that he is the president of this organization. He was on the news, he was leading the parade, he was speaking well about, you know, Ivy, the people that came and did the presentation?
UCIV. UCIV and
UCIV. I thought that was a positive message that they were sending to the community. Mm-hmm. So I think we have to think about on fundraising, really, I think that where we have the best chance of raising funds, that we should send Ethan, and maybe if George has a connection there or I have a connection there, I think we should use Ethan as the point, as the president, and we should generally help send another committee member with him to solicit. And I think,
but you're saying he does the grant writing, because I thought that's what we were talking about.
I think eventually you got to open the door for the grant. So if you know, and that's why I really want to talk to the IBCDC, because they're doing the same thing we should be doing. They're going to the Santa Barbara Foundation. They're already doing the grant writing.
Are they at the Santa Barbara Foundation?
I guess that's what Jonathan said at the meeting.
I think they're at the Fund for Santa Barbara.
They're at the Fund.
Oh, Fund for Santa Barbara.
They're applying for a fund grant.
Yeah. So,
and I don't know if the fund gives money to local governments.
Who?
I don't know if the fund gives money to local governments.
Well, they're flexible enough that they could figure out a way.
Yeah, to do. I know they've been pretty friendly to Isla Vista as a whole in the last couple of years.
And you know, the time is opportune right now.
You know, my other thing is, I've never in my career, because I was the auditor, was involved in fundraising activities, because it pretty much would create a conflict of interest in anything I do. So I'm not I'm not an experienced fundraiser like you are.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't want to lead that effort, because I don't know how to lead that effort.
No, and my question was only, my real question to you personally was, do you want to keep this in this committee, because if it's, the way I see it is there'll be a whole bunch of people, and it's not necessarily you, and I think your idea about Ethan is perfect. Ethan is the closer. He's the guy you bring in at the end and go, here. But if you're talking about something like Santa Barbara Foundation, I mean, we've been in discussions now with the Santa Barbara Foundation about funding. They funded the planning process, right? The visioning process.
That's right.
And they want to fund more. And we've been in discussions with them for 8 months now.
Oh, you have?
But it's not about the CSD. But here's where it breaks down is, I have a vision about what we should get money, and it's very close to what the CSD wants. But our clients, who are the actual people on the ground, don't share that vision. So my vision, which the foundation is very excited about, is to fund a community engagement center housed in the Precious Slut Tattoo Parlor that engages faculty in projects in Isla Vista, working in close consultation with the CSD. And as part of that, you know, you could have space in there for the CSD. But that's kind of, and that hasn't gone anywhere. So my sense is the Santa Barbara Foundation wants to do something in Isla Vista, but they don't want to fund operational things that just you fund and then it's gone. They want to fund transformative. Now, we're transformative at this moment, but I don't know how long we'll be transformative. But I say all that because the process would be is, you know, I would go back there and say, well, so what would you fund out here? And then I come back here and say, are you all, you know, is the board interested in that kind of funding? there'd probably be six different viewpoints. I'd try and take that back to the foundation. The foundation would say, well, you know, really, we're only interested in this. That's what's involved with the for the Santa Barbara Foundation. Now, the university is a different story, and we briefly talked about that. And the letter has started a discussion going over there. And I would say at this point, the discussion is positive. But we need to be careful about, because just like the people at the county are reading, the people at the university are reading the news accounts and wondering, are we going to fund a dysfunctional operation?
That's one of the things I've been most concerned about, and I don't want to get too much into it.
Yeah, let's not talk about
it. But I mean, it looks
really universe.
I think we can talk about it in the context of my conversation with the county of trying to get a majority support.
Yeah.
I flat out got, as the discussion started, we were going to talk about IVCSD, I got a flat out, very stern, whatever you're going to suggest is no. And then Kenneth proceeded to be, but I'll listen to you. What do you want to ask for? And I brought up the building, and I brought up accounting services.
Yeah.
And I believe that the county, my original appointment, when Lavanino said, don't come here and ask for general fund money, they are going to... they're sticking to that gun because those members on LAFCO just they didn't like the form of the district and with the possibility of no money. And I think they made it clear in LAFCO is, well, if they're gonna do that, don't have them come up asking the county. And so I'm trying to figure out, number one, I have the keys to that room right now, just for inspection purposes. Just so we can look at it and say, what are we asking for, you know, as part of this agenda item. And I just can't figure out a way to get there. I tried to craft a little bit of a, see if I can open the door, you know, by saying, well, what if we had, you know, free lease space for 3 years, and when we get the, when we get tax money, we will take an equivalent amount of money, and that will be our first investment back into these facilities. And I didn't even get a little
really?
Bite. No.
That's discouraging. That
not
is
even
discouraging.
A bite. So then my only thing now is, can we raise enough money to pay, you know, lease rental space? And you know, the other thing is,
what do we have to pay to the county?
Well, I don't know. Mona was supposed to get me the cost of the equivalent lease rental, because, you know, the Isla Vista Youth Project bid on that space. And so they don't feel like they can just give us the space without...
Do you have any idea? I mean, what are we talking about? $200 a month or $2,000 a month?
I don't know. I'll get the number, though.
I wish I
could. We need to get that.
Find out.
What?
That would be good to find out.
Yeah.
Because once we have numbers like that, then, I mean, as we continue to have conversations about what a fundraising drive is going to look like, then we have a tangible thing that we can raise money towards that's more than just abstract, you know, operational stuff.
Right. Which I'm afraid to even try and get a commitment from the county because of that, what I got on my visit. I just go, God, just give me a chance.
Well, so Youth Projects bid on the building or
when the county opened this up to other governmental agencies and nonprofits to lease space, there was some competition for the space, so they opened it as a form of a proposal and a bid.
That's right.
And those, you guys are paying too, right, George?
And that's the upstairs space, correct? Or is that specific room?
That specific room has always been a community room used by the third district. And
that's right.
They kind of hoodwinked it and got it for no cost. But
I don't see why the third district gets to, I mean, I don't know.
Just
it's unfortunate.
It's the county's building.
I know it's the county's
building. They can do what they want with the damn thing.
That room has sat vacant, essentially, or.
It's too bad.
Yeah.
And I tried to remind the board, this is a community building that was bought with all the other taxing agencies' money. Yeah. And I tried to pull the string that 50% of this whole building was bought by K-12 schools.
Mm-hmm. No, that's right.
No, there's no memory of that.
That's a county's building.
It's a county's building now.
I can't remember anything before 2011.
Yeah.
Well, and that.
Well, nobody understands.
So let me ask you this. Let me ask this committee. So here's where we're going to get into. I've already informally begun to do some fundraising, but I don't want to get hung out there to dry at a board meeting where my motives or my ethics or my morality is questioned. If you're going to question my morality, you can talk about my drug use, you know, but don't talk about me going out and fundraising.
Yeah.
So I've already informally, just full disclosure, talked to Jeff Green this week about you guys at City College need to step up and fund some interns out here. And he's very open to that idea. Obviously, I'm in continuing discussions with UCSB. They've already indicated that I will not participate in any decision-making process for specifically where money will go. They've made that determination. But I want to at least have this committee's feeling that, do you want me to continue to ask people questions and ask the Santa Barbara Foundation, what role do you see, and ask City College, or do we need to, is that a problem?
I think experienced fundraisers at our board of directors, we should make sure that our directors are authorized to go talk to people, and if we want to assign, you know, on this whole list, if we want to say, hey, Bob, you should go talk to the county,
mm-hmm.
and I can say, I did talk to the county, and they already authored me to talk to the county, you know, and I don't have any good news from the county. But I think we should pick out those other.
Well, the next person that is on my list is a local landlord. And it seems to me, and obviously that's where we start to get into some tricky waters.
Property owner in Isla Vista or outside?
Yes, property owner in Isla Vista.
Well, here's what I would say about this. So in our work plan that we have, that was approved by the board, correct? It was approved by the board that this is the thing, these are some things the formation committee is going to work on.
Mm-hmm.
And one of those things is fundraising, correct? It's something pertaining to fundraising. I don't have a copy in front of me, so I'm asking.
Okay.
If that's the case, then I certainly agree that people who are experienced fundraisers should be the ones designated to do that. But there, I think Bob's right as well. There does need to be some sort of formal designation. Because otherwise we get into the situation that I've been seeing a lot where certain board members will try to go back and say, well, I didn't have any hand in that decision. I didn't support that decision, even if they didn't ever have to take a formal vote against it. And this kind of goes back to just something that's about the process that I've been noticing, which is that it's really important that we understand that we all have our voice in a specific decision, and we can voice our opinions, and that's the best part about government, is that we voice our opinions and deliberate. But once the decision's been made, you gotta support, or you can't do things as a director to undermine the decision that the board made. And I'm really concerned that we're going to start getting into that territory.
So give me some guidance here, because let me tell is a fundraiser. Listen, this is not fun work, okay? And as experienced as I am, it's not ever at the very top of my list in the morning.
Yeah.
In fact, it's quite low.
Yeah.
So the last thing I want to do is to do something that's difficult, which requires me to ask people for favors.
I understand.
For money, for all these things, and then feel like I did something wrong.
Yeah. Well, I think what the board did is, you know, they kind of, after the donation discussion, they kind of referred the donation policy back to the policy committee to formulate it. And then they referred to us, and I wrote this down, discuss referral by district board, the issue of a strategic plan for donations. So I think the minutes are going to say, they kind of threw the football at us to come up with a strategic plan for donations. And I think George did a great job of identifying not only donations, but, you know, contributions from other governments and all that. So I'm not sure, in my experience, of how to come up with a strategic plan to do that. I heard Jonathan say four issues of what they were going to do, and a couple of them I went, whoa! Like, you know, in George, you put that on here, the pay the tax forward, your share of UUT. You know, I'm kind of going, oh, is that, are we going to be successful asking for voluntary donations of people calculating how much their UUT would be and making that an issue of as part of a next election?
Well, see, and that's one that needs to go to the election. Well, I totally agree with you. Is when I first heard the idea, it's really good. It's really kind of a smart, clever idea. But then as you think about it politically, when we go to present the next tax, it's got to be done exactly right. And it's not like people out in the streets going, wait a minute, what are they talking about here?
Yeah.
What is this thing? And
you go start calculating this for a landlord, and the landlord turns around and uses it against us and say, your rents are going to go up by this amount of money because they're asking, ludicrous how much tax they're going to ask you to pay. And so I'm just going, ooh.
Yeah. My whole thing is that on any kind of election, as you know, being a successful politician, is the message has to be crafted exactly right.
Yeah, that's right.
Particularly when it comes to a tax. And this has all the earmarks of something that could go in, you know.
Yeah. And well, when you said we have to tell a compelling story, then it made me think about, we need to get back on point about what it is as an organization that we're empowered to deliver for the community, and be very articulate about what our long-term funding stream is going to do for the community. So that just made me think to go back to that section of the law, that we're going to raise money for what? Well, we're going to raise money for carrying out these issues when we get a tax. And this is how we're going to be successful as an organization, because that 130-page document that Jonathan has somehow got boiled down into, you know, LAFCO operations to do these various things. And of course then Jay listens to public comment and says, well, let's go look at our latent powers. And I go, whoa, we don't want to go pick that fight with LAFCO, and we haven't buried the last fight and we haven't accomplished anything. Don't let that crack.
So maybe this prompts the discussion of, back to my idea a while ago, as much as I hate meetings, is that we have a special meeting of the CSD to discuss what I'm now calling the 180-day plan, which is, and in that discussion, when we're done with it, we say, and the media is there, so the meeting has to be over in 2 hours, this is what we're going to focus on for the next, and this is how we're going to improve Isla Vista over the next year.
Is that something we can do? I'm still very supportive of having this sort of a visioning workshop type of thing. I think that we had kind of wanted to do it last, or it was supposed to be scheduled for 2 days ago, but then we had the scheduling conflict, so I certainly think that it's a great idea, and if there's any sort of thing that this committee can do in order to make sure that that meeting goes as smoothly as possible by having some sort of, I don't know if it's a format, because the way I'm envisioning it is it's not the same kind of, quite the same kind of format that we have at the board level. I think it would be good for us to have like presentations on hand about different the different kind of things that we would want to do at a service level down the road within this 180-day plan, the things that we're going to be moving towards, the different things that this committee is working on, the different things that the other committees are working on, and try to make it as large of an event as possible, do as much outreach as possible so that we do kind of reclaim that sort of vision, that kind of narrative, reclaim the narrative, if you will.
Yeah, I think you got to start with the service delivery,
mm-hmm.
you know, long term, short term, and then how are we going to fundraise for it?
Right.
Because if we're going to go ask people for money,
right.
You know, it's just like coming back to the university. What are we going to spend our $200,000 on? Well, the university says, well, what are you going to do? What's your plan to, what are you going to do for the community? And we need to, you know, in your original document you did for the first 90 days, you started linking that up, you know? Hey, we want to provide funding for student policing with the university money. The university probably thinks that's a good idea, but how are we going to assist them in accomplishing it?
Yeah.
You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. I mean, is it worth it for us to make some sort of a recommendation on this to the board and kind of get the process rolling? Because I know that we approved a calendar, sure. that had a special meeting, and the intention was for it to be then. But
so I'll move. I this is under agenda item revenue expectations.
And the discussion of the strategic plan for donations, we yeah. brought that in there.
So the
well, the visioning workshop ties into both of these things.
Exactly. So yeah. I would make the motion that we recommend to the board that they schedule a special meeting of a limited duration in terms of time. It's got to be before the end of spring quarter, quickly, that would focus on services that we can provide
long term and short term.
Although I'm more
number two, yeah. tying revenue resources to the right. delivery of those services. And what was the third one? Three, or is that it? Two,
I think it's two.
Keep it that simple.
Yeah, one is
tell a compelling story, develop a compelling story of how we can accomplish that. I mean, that I like your, if we don't turn to a positive message, we end up more with Jay's crap. I'm sorry to say that, but that did not have a good effect from the.
Yeah. Can I also say that if we do that relatively quickly, it'll mesh and link up with what the university is starting to do, which is they're going to go through the same, and I don't think I'm telling any stories, they're going to go through the same process, which is over there, they're going to sit there and go, what kind of projects could we fund
yeah.
that will make a difference? And if there's a two-way, mm-hmm. and they plan, by the way, they totally plan for it to be a two-way conversation.
Mm-hmm. And I suggest if we can't find a special meeting date, that we just substitute that agenda item for a regular meeting. It's so important for us to.
Mm-hmm. I think the special meeting is going to be better.
What?
I think it'll be a lot better. I think we can definitely find a special meeting date. I think it'd be good. I think that it would have us like give us a focal point. So that the narrative wouldn't yeah, get lost
I,
in a bunch
I,
of other
I,
things.
I agree, but if you we can't, since okay. we haven't found one, I would just suggest that it happen, you know, it doesn't have to be, it should be at one of the meetings in May.
Mm-hmm.
The first one, if we can't, we're not going to get it done any sooner. We're already, what's our next meeting?
Our next meeting is the 18th.
Yeah, and coming our up next meeting week. Is the 21st.
Then after that, the first May meeting, I believe, is the, let me find it, the 2nd. And then there's another May meeting on the 16th.
Yeah,
so
I think
maybe in between those 2 weeks, are you thinking the week of the 7th through the 13th?
I think we should just bring up on the next calendar, schedule a special meeting to talk about well, you know, delivery of services and
so that was I'm writing this as a motion that you made a motion that we recommend to the board that we hold a special meeting to craft a long and short-term service strategy and tie it into a method to fund those services while telling a compelling story.
And as part of that, does that drive the issue of when we're going to go to for a tax again, if we put the long-term portion in there? Or should we
is service delivery and revenue what
we're
going
to tie it, yeah, because we're tying it to revenue.
Yeah,
so we're going to come up with a
short and long
plan.
We're not even going to worry about these other services that we're authorized to provide until we get a tax.
Right.
But here's the things we're going to try and accomplish before we get a tax, and here's how we potentially can do it.
Right.
Using the university's money, using.
Right. And I do want to, since this is part of this broader, well, let's keep the motion. You made the motion, I'll second it.
Call for the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
For
an hour and 15 minutes, we're 10 minutes late.
There is just one other item, which is in terms of, and I don't, let me
you
see
guys
if
want
I
to tour the office before we leave?
Wait, we have one other item?
No, I just want to, it's just, I'm trying to figure out which thing I'm going to put it under for terms of agenda. Which
for
is
a future item.
A future formation committee item.
Yeah.
Okay.
Deltopia.
Mm-hmm.
And you, as the secretary to the board, we need to get our arms around that baby, or
mm-hmm.
somebody else is going to get it, and we're going to be left standing on
I agree.
The sidelines.
I could not agree more.
So however we do that, I don't want to talk about it because it's not really on the agenda, but somehow we as the community service district need to be a player at the table. And pretty quickly there's going to be some serious discussions because mm-hmm. this one wasn't
as good as the last one.
No, it wasn't. We slipped a little. But that's the conventional thing.
See, it's interesting that people keep saying that. I've heard the exact opposite. And it continues to baffle me how there's these two competing
Well, maybe
areas.
Offline, can we adjourn and then you and I talk about that? As
yeah, no, I'd
committee.
Love to talk to you. I wish I could have. Well, that is, so, in terms of the agenda item, though.
Should we put that, the Delta
on the formation
committee agenda?
Sure, sure. I don't know that it's. But it's more. It's about how I think in terms of formation, it would be how does the CSD play a role in special events that
yes,
occur in
Iowa? Yes, I 100% agree. I think that's something that we should definitely.
So tell me why you thought, while we're talking about this, is an agenda adding new agenda. Why did you think it was lower key?
Why did I think it was lower key? Because of the numbers that came out of it and the experience that I had attending the event and talking to people that were in attendance of the event.
Okay. Well, that's good.
It was, I mean, even in my experience talking to the foot patrol officers, to be frank with you, not to put them on the spot, but at 3:00, they thought it was going great.
Okay. So they.
But, I mean, we shouldn't talk about it too much in this meeting. It's not something we're agendized to talk about. We can
speak
about it.
I'd rather talk about it off.
Yeah.
We adjourn. Don't we adjourn?
Do you want to take a tour before we adjourn?
Sure.
Yeah. We are. If we're under that agenda item,
we
can take a tour.
I think we gotta go. But actually, this door is open, so you can probably go from here to there.
Yeah. So the couple of things that I just talked to while we're in the hallway.
Yeah.
So first of all, the first problem we have is.
Yeah, we need to adjourn the meeting.
I'll just announce that
we, as the board, did a site visit of the former 3rd District office, and now we're ready to adjourn the meeting. Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
George said he was going to yell from the bathroom. I think I heard him.
Cool.
All right.